Hello. For the penultimate match of the 2011 tournament, the teams from the Midlands and Wales pay their last visit to our Round Britain quiz hideaway in Rutland. Rosalind Miles and Stephen Maddock of the Midlands and David Edwards and Mifanwy Alexander of Wales have all been doing pretty well in the series so far, but last time they met, Midlands were the winners. With both teams playing their last fixture of the season, there's quite a bit at stake. So we're handing out pieces of paper to both teams just now, carrying the text of the questions they have to tackle in the next half hour. And before we let them loose, let's just pick up the thread of the teaser question I set you last week. I asked what you might be making if you were using a trail through the woods, an explosion, a child's toy, and some blondes and redheads. Those were all clues to things used on a film set. Blondes and redheads are types of lights. Trail through the wood is a track, an explosion, a boom, and a child's toy, a dolly. So well done if you got that. The teams have had time to get a grip on their first question. So Midlands, Stephen and Rosalind, would you look at this for us today, please? How long is the stairway that takes you to meet someone better informed than he should be, shows you the view from the back of the house, giving you a fear of heights, at which point you meet the well-informed person all over again before going insane and finally ending up in your grave? How long is the stairway that takes you to meet someone better informed than he should be, shows you the view from the back of the house, giving you a fear of heights, at which point you meet the well-informed person all over again before going insane and finally ending up in your grave?
Well, we think this may be a stairway that doesn't lead all the way to heaven, but perhaps has 39 steps to it.
Very good. I think you've the essence of this. Can you get all the...
Okay, so 39 steps, John Buchan book, but filmed by Hitchcock, starring Robert Donat. And we think we've got a few more Hitchcock films here. So that someone who is better informed than he should be would be the man who knew too much.
Yeah, that's right.
Then the view from the back of the house gives us rear window.
Yep.
James Stewart,
excellent.
wonderful film.
At which point we meet the well-informed person all over again.
Fear of heights.
Fear of heights, vertigo.
Very good, yes.
We meet the well-informed person all over again because I think he remade The Man Who Knew Too Much.
He
made it twice, once in the 30s, once in the 50s or something like that.
Absolutely right, yes.
Filmed at the Royal Albert Hall.
Strictly speaking, you'd have met him before you got the fear of heights because he made it before Vertigo.
Before Vertigo. Yeah.
Then the person who goes insane, psycho...
Yep.
And then finally ending up in your grave. Okay, we need to dredge up one more Hitchcock film. It's not Rope, and it's not Strangers on a Train.
No, finally is relevant here.
Finally end.
Finally is relevant, certainly for Hitchcock.
His last film. Was it the Trap? No.
No.
Ending up in your grave, dead. So after Psycho, because Psycho is about 1960.
Psycho is 1960. This is much later, yeah, 1976 film.
Marnie, no.
Didn't he do one with Kim Novak?
She's in Vertigo.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's not just your grave.
Anyone's
grave.
Those
related to you as well.
Cemetery, family tomb. Family grave?
No, you're very close.
Family.
Vault.
It's a word you'd always associate with Hitchcock films, but also with a cemetery space.
Oh,
Family Vault.
They're called plot thriller. No, family plot.
Plot. You got there just in the end. Yes, Family Plot, Hitchcock's very last film, which he made in 1976. You did extremely well there. I can only take away 1 point, I think, for a helpful little lunch occasionally. So that's 5 to you, Midlands. Very good start for them. Wales, can you match it or better it with this? What would a philanthropist with an aversion to Mondays, the Goons harmonica player, and all of the inhabitants of Arnhem do to a horse? What would a philanthropist with an aversion to Mondays, the Goons harmonica player, and all of the inhabitants of Arnhem do to a horse?
Well, talking about my generation, I don't like Mondays takes you to the Boomtown Rats, and therefore would the philanthropist then would be Bob Geldof?
Yes, it would.
Yes. And the inhabitants of Arnhem, I'm wondering whether it's Gelderland. Do they live in are they Gelds then from Gelderland?
Gelder.
Yes.
The Goons harmonica player was Max Geldray. So what would they do to a horse? Tricky one, this.
I think you're playing with it.
I think they would
remove
well.
Part of his tack, I would think.
Yes, his wedding tackle, yes. As we say in agricultural circles.
Well, say the word.
Geld.
Geld. They would geld him, yes, because all of these names or titles begin with the word geld. The philanthropist with an aversion to Mondays is Bob Geldof because of his hit I Don't Like Mondays. The Goons harmonica player was Max Geldray. And finally, all of the inhabitants of Arnhem, you would also know Arnhem as Gelderland, and they would be known as the Gelders. So you've got that exactly right. I think we can't dock anything, unlike the horse. You get 6 points. So, Midlands. How is this music connected with the father of quantum physics, a pioneer of movie makeup, and a computer-generated talk show host? And why would you struggle to turn them up any louder? Rosalind and Stephen, how is that music connected with the father of quantum physics, a pioneer of movie makeup and a computer-generated talk show host, and why would you struggle to turn them up any louder?
OK. We're going to answer the question and then go back and identify the music.
OK, so you can, it's your choice.
The father of quantum physics, we think, is Max Planck.
Yeah,
came up with Planck's constant, which was a number that was either incredibly large or incredibly small, and I can't now remember which, but it was to do with the probability of where things end up, and they can be in more than one place at once.
That's right. There's no DNA testing in these things. I'm sure there'll be people screaming out Niels Bohr or Schrödinger, but Max Planck is the one you're
I think
for.
Will help us here.
Yeah.
And the pioneer of movie makeup was the inventor of that glorious orange slap, which you still see on people's faces to this day, Max Factor.
That's right. Yep.
And the computer-generated talk show host was an incredibly annoying programme on, I think, Channel 4, though it might not have been, in the 1980s. And he was called Max Headroom.
That's right.
This was kind of pre-CGI, anything decent at all. So he sort of shimmered on the screen and was...
Well, in fact, I think he was actually created out of makeup, partly. I mean, the animation wasn't sufficiently advanced, so it was pretend animation. Yeah.
And you'd struggle to turn them up any louder because you're on max volume... already.
So that is absolutely right. Now, what about the music?
So there was I hoping you would play Max Brooks' First Violin Concerto. but it clearly was not Max Brooks. Other composers with Max as the first name could include Steiner, Max, or Maximilian. Much more familiar. So there's an obvious composer we should be thinking of.
I think you will kick yourself.
Yeah, we will, won't we? Okay, well, give us a moment, Max. Oh, Peter Maxwell Davis.
You got
it. Of course,
that.
Max. Indeed. Sorry, I was thinking it was another name to go after, known as Max. So right. Peter Maxwell Davis, yes. The master of the Queen's music.
Not strictly speaking his first name, but known to his friends
right.
very often.
Indeed.
It's Max.
Indeed.
Yes. So we played you a bit of Peter Maxwell Davis, Second Fantasia on an In Nomine by John Taverner. And that was a clue to the music connected with the father of quantum physics, Max Planck. A pioneer of movie makeup was Max Factor. And finally, the computer-generated talk show host was Max Headroom. And you correctly identified that you would struggle to turn them up any louder because they're already on Max, unless, of course, your amplifier goes to 11. That's brilliantly answered. You came straight back to Wales with a six-point question. Wales... listen to these pieces of music and tell me, in what sense are all of these performers also producers?
I knew the movie of Peter Weir, and I knew the exactly the same... I found the same family, because he loves mysteries, and each movie, you just see one kiss, but before the kiss, you have the seduction round, for example, the beautiful kiss between Mel Gibson and Sigourney Weaver. It's a little bit like François Truffaut, you know, and when I read the script, I say, great. You ask yourself
Okay, so in what sense are all of these performers also producers? It looked as though you had an aha moment halfway there, yeah. But then it faded. Is it
deeply faded?
Well, have a go anyway.
Right, well, we can recognise the first clip as being Cliff Richard, Lucky Lips.
Yep.
The place where we thought we'd got a light bulb moment was on the third one. We thought it was Sting, and then we changed our mind that we don't think it is. Is it Sting?
Don't change your mind.
Right, no. So it's Sting.
It's Sting, yes. And so does that switch the light bulb back on for you?
Maybe. The middle one, again, we were clutching at straws. We're wondering if it's the French director, Jarre.
No, it isn't, no. Wonderfully Gaelic voice, but yeah. Sorry, it's not a director.
Right.
You're right, he was talking about films, but not a director.
So is he... Who else? Gérard Depardieu.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah,
Depardieu. Yeah. So how a producer? We wondered if there might be a reference in their names or original names, and that Cliff Richard was born Harry Webb, which would have implied somewhere many, many generations back that one of his forebears was a weaver and therefore a producer of fine woven cloth.
Well, it's wonderfully ingenious, but it's wrong.
That's the light bulb.
All right, the light bulb
suffering a power cut.
Okay.
If you're going to uncork this question, you're going to have to think about the word producers in a different sense.
So is it to do with, are they producing some form of liquid? Is it because is it Ricard, like a pastis?
No, it isn't. They are producing some form of liquid. Yes, I don't know what led you to that, but they are.
Right. Are these brands of drink or types of drink? A cocktail?
Not brands, not cocktails, no, but we are talking about drinks.
We are talking about, right.
Yeah.
So Cliff Richard, Harry Webb. Gordon's gin for Sting.
No. You're going off down a side.
So it is Sting. It's still Sting. It's still Sting that we're looking for rather than Gordon Sumner.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. But the name is not going to help you in any of these cases. The name is not a clue to anything. It's
all right. So is it some song that
all
they
of
have
these all
performed.
Of these people have something in common? They share an interest outside of them.
Oh, they've got their own vineyards.
We got right. there.
Yeah.
Yes. We got there.
Produce
yes.
wine.
Yeah. Yes. I don't suppose.
I'm sorry, not how to, thick we were.
But, yeah. I'm not going to ask you to name the labels, the particular labels. I think that would be too much to ask. They all own vineyards and produce wine under their own labels. Cliff Richard owns a winery in Portugal, makes a wine called Vila Nova. Gérard Depardieu owns a winery at the Château de Tine in Anjou. And Sting produces Chianti from his Tuscan estate. So quite hard work that. I always feel if I've done too much work, I take some points off you. So I think we can only give you 4 there, Wales. So, Midlands, now it's time for the listeners' contributions. This one's from Rosie Daly in Winscombe in North Somerset, who said some very nice things about the programme. I'm not sure you'll be saying nice things about her when you've tackled this, but be polite. If one is together, 2 is apart, 3 is joined halfway along, 4 goes forward and 5 rejoins at the end, which art form results? If one is together, 2 is apart, 3 is joined halfway along, 4 goes forward and 5 rejoins at the end. Which art form results?
Well, we thank Rosie Daly for her question.
No, we don't.
And wish her well. But we are struggling to find any way into this. So we're looking for some kind of sequence of things here. Is it a sequence of books or works of art or films of some sort?
Not of books or works of art, no.
Right.
But it is a sequence.
It's a sequence of things.
A well-known sequence.
Well-known sequence. Is it like a saying of some sort?
No, it isn't.
No, okay,
but it is an art form.
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, one
music.
Is together.
Well, you can work by process of elimination through all of them. I'm not sure I'm going to let you do that.
No,
you're going to need the right attitude to approach this question.
The right attitude. One is together. So is this a sequence of works that are numbered?
No.
Number one, number two, number three.
No, if you're thinking about a sequence of works, you're in the wrong place. I'm going to...
Albums.
You really need to stand on your own 2 feet on this one. I can't give you too many clues.
Stand on our own 2 feet.
Ballet.
Ballet.
Oh, yes. They're the positions. Of course. First position, second position, third position, fourth.
Rosalind just demonstrated them all on the radio,
yes,
didn't you?
If only the listeners
So first
could...
position is...
First
two feet
position
together.
is together in a V shape. Two is apart and parallel. Three is joined halfway together in... if only Miss Wendy Matthews could see me now. Yeah. graduate as I was of her 5-year-old dancing school. Four goes forward.
One foot in front of the other.
Yes, and five rejoins at the
Extremely
end.
Extremely tricky to put these positions into words, but yes. I think Rosie Daly has done pretty well there. And you did finally get it. I had to nudge you a lot.
The odd form is ballet.
Great hefty shoves of the elbow to get you there in the end. I think we'll give you four generously because you did know all of the positions once we'd established that it was ballet. Thank you again, Rosie Daly, for your question. If you want to send in a question, you can do it to rbq@bbc.co.uk. That email address is on our website. And you can also there get a free download of the programme, incidentally, if that's something you want to do. So, Mifanwi and David, you get a question from Stuart Booth in Dorset. Why might a type of measurement and an oddity of diet, when juxtaposed, become an omen of sorrow? Why might a type of measurement and an oddity of diet, when juxtaposed, become an omen of sorrow?
Well, sorrow led us in the direction of one for sorrow, two for joy. A magpie would be right. Although
yes, you would be.
It's the opposite way in Wales. One magpie is good news to a sorrow. But so, are we thinking in terms of a magpie?
You are. Yes.
Right. That makes us initially think of juxtaposing mag and pie, but. Pie's never an oddity of diet. That's a staple, isn't it?
Yes.
Or are we looking possibly... I mean, magpie is pica pica, the Latin name, and I can see a link between pica and the type of measurement. If you precede any measure in the SI with the prefix pica, P-I-C-A, that implies a unit which is 10 to the minus 12 times as large. So it's a millionth of a millionth.
Well, you've come up with a perfectly fair answer, it seems to me, but it's not the one that we were looking for.
Right.
Is pica, you know the thing where a pregnant woman wants to eat something very unusual, like earth, yeah? In my case, it was always toast and golden syrup.
Yes, but I don't think that counts as unusual.
Exactly. But that's sort of pica.
Pica is absolutely the name given to an eating disorder, very often in women, but not necessarily, where you eat foodstuffs that are highly unusual anyway.
Right.
Coal, earth, kaolin.
And it's supposed to make up for some mineral deficiency, apparently.
Either mineral deficiency. Yeah. It's also, I mean, in some cases it's thought not to be a disorder at all. It's just a cultural practice and it's to do with avoiding toxins in a diet.
So we need to come up with the type of measurement that you mean rather than...
Well, I don't know whether you do, to be honest, because you've come up with a perfectly rational and perfectly true account of why a type of measurement might be a pica. It's not the one we had. The word type is significant here. I don't know whether that'll nudge...
Well, I would think of as perhaps pica as implying... a type of measurement, a reduced size of unit.
Well, no, more specifically what we're looking for, pica is a measurement within typography.
A pica is one sixth of an inch.
So that was why, that was the type of measurement we
were
looking
for. I was thinking
for.
Science when I saw measurement rather than mere typing. But.
Well, as I say, I really don't, I'm not quite sure whether we can penalise you having given a perfectly creditable and... undeniably true answer to that. So it would be unkind of us to take even a pica of a point away from you. So you get the full six for that, Wales. So Midlands, why might a Brazilian supermodel, a melancholy engraver, and Princess Ida's beloved collectively get the willies? Why might a Brazilian supermodel, a melancholy engraver, and Princess Ida's beloved collectively get the willies?
Well, we think the melancholy engraver is Dürer, Albrecht Dürer, with his famous, terrifying image of Melancholia as this woman driven mad by grief and fear and...
Rosalind's drawn it here, just here on her paper.
If only the listeners could see
that. I wish that,
that
was true, yes. And then we'd put it on the website yes. for you. But
all my skills are coming out.
Okay. But Dürer is the person we're going to need here.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
So Princess Ida's beloved, Prince Albrecht?
No.
Well, Princess Ida is an operetta by Gilbert and Sullivan, one of the less often performed ones.
That's right, yes.
And alas, it is too long since I saw it, so I can't remember who she falls in love with. She's very sort of domineering, Princess Ida, I seem to remember. And that it has, the plot is something to do with... It's a satire on sort of feminism, it's women's rights.
Yes, it's kind of parody of Tennyson and...
Right, so, yeah. Things.
What about... going to the willies.
If you get the willies, that just means you're very fearful. Or it could be that these are all sprites, because willies are sprites.
Follow that line.
Okay, spirits so sort of nature.
Spirits of the air, I think, or water.
And in fact, the willies aren't they in the chorus of Princess Ida? Or they're in one of the GLS.
The Ilanthe.
Ilanthe.
They're also
famously in another work, and that's what we're trying to drive you to here.
The willies are... Well, the Will of the Wisps are in The Damnation of Faust. Albrecht. So we need another work in which there's a character called Albrecht.
That's what we're looking for, yes. Does the Brazilian supermodel, does that help you at all?
We were debating whether that's a supermodel who's had a Brazilian or whether she is Brazilian by birth.
No, Brazilian by birth.
Because presumably otherwise it doesn't rule many of them out.
Well, alas, neither of us is a great reader of Heat magazine and such, but we would venture Gisela von Bunden?
Very close to Giselle.
Okay, well, Giselle is also a... So in the ballet Giselle, the male hero is called Albrecht.
That's right.
Yeah.
And there's a chorus of these spirits.
There is. There's a dance of the Dance of the Willies.
The Dance of the Willies. And you've got Giselle, you've got Albrecht, you've got the Willies, you've established what they are. What about...
Princess Ida's Beloved, is that another character in it?
It's the only sort of stage work we can think of that has a character called this name.
Willie.
Adolf.
No. I don't think you're going to get this, and I'm not sure that I can get you to it by process of deduction. It's Hilarion.
Hilarion.
The ballad is Albrecht's rival for the love of Giselle.
Right.
So why might a Brazilian supermodel, a melancholy engraver, and Princess Ida's beloved collectively get the willies? These were all clues to the ballet Giselle, in which the willies are zombie virgins, sort of take their revenge on men. Giselle was the Brazilian supermodel. That was a clue from Giselle Bundchen. The melancholy engraver you got very quickly was Albrecht Dürer, which gave you Albrecht. And finally, Princess Ida's beloved was Hilarion, who is the name of the other major character in Giselle. So I think, because we're feeling generous, we'll give you 4, and you started well. 4 points to you, Midlands. So, Wales, your last question of the programme. The chief purveyors of Kensington Gore, an old book on witchcraft, or the tool of Thor could help your hearing. How and what other items of ironmongery might you need? The chief purveyors of Kensington Gore, an old book on witchcraft, or the tool of Thor could help your hearing. How and what other items of ironmongery might you need?
Well, we thought we'd hammer this out between us.
All right, you've got there.
Thinking of the witchcraft, Malleus Maleficarum, was that James the first book on witchcraft?
Well, it was a bit earlier, in fact, late sort of 15th century. So,
which is the Hammer of the Witches, wasn't it?
Yes.
A sort of a how-to guide to do your own Salem at home type of thing, and Thor had a hammer, which he didn't hammer in the morning all over this land, but he did have a hammer. So, which meant that Kensington Gore is horror films, Hammer, House of Horror, yes?
Exactly, yeah. Not exactly, I suppose.
Hammer films.
Big users of Kensington Gore. Explain why Kensington Gore, for those who don't know.
Artificial blood.
Theatrical blood.
Yes.
Right. So, you've established the
hammer.
What about the other items of
well,
Arnhem.
I think we're looking for a connection here between the round and the oval window, as they say in play school. But in this particular case, we're talking about the middle ear. And between the round window and oval window, transmitting vibration, are three bonelets, ossicles, one of which is the hammer, the malleus. The other two being the anvil and the stirrup, the incus and the stapes. And they presumably are the bits of ironmongery which the question's asking for.
Very good indeed. You hammered that question. We were looking initially for a hammer. Kensington Gore, chief purveyors of Kensington Gore, you could say were the hammer horror movies. An old book on witchcraft was the Malleus Maleficarum, or the Hammer of Witches, or the Hexen Hammer, as it's known in German. And the tool of Thor was his hammer. Molnar, I think, is the correct name for his hammer. What other items of ironmongery might you need? An anvil and a stirrup, those being the names of the other two little bones in the construction that transmits sound waves. So, very well done, Wales. You finish with a 6, top score. Which means that the scores at the end of today's contest are the Midlands 19 and Wales 22. They pulled away at the end. So Wales are today's winners. Congratulations to you. And that means that with all of your matches over, both Midlands and Wales have got 2 wins, 1 draw and 1 loss. The final contest is between Northern Ireland and Scotland, for which we very much hope you'll join us. By RBQ tradition, all of the questions next week have been thought up by listeners. And so has the cliffhanger for today from Andrew Walker in St. Peterport in Guernsey. Mr. Walker asks this: why would a badge of courage, a tropical fever and half of a rock band give you a winning combination? Why would a badge of courage, a tropical fever and half of a rock band give you a winning combination? You can find the question on our webpage all week, and I'll tell you the answer at the beginning of the last programme of the series next week. Until then, goodbye.